Hey guys, welcome back to my channel and welcome to another true crime video. So this one that I'm about to tell you about is one that I'm sure a lot of you have at least heard of or are somewhat familiar with, because this really made national attention and world attention when this happened a few years ago. It is one of those cases that I've followed for a while. So there are a lot of people in this case. I'm gonna be telling you about all of them and how their lives would very unfortunately collide on one random summer night. This is Eric, Shelby, and Holly Boyles. They had a really gorgeous house in Burleson, I think that's how you say it, Burleson, Texas, on the night of June 15th of 2013. Their 21-year-old daughter, Shelby, was currently on break from nursing school, so they were kind of catching up with her, hanging out, watching a movie, having a really nice family Saturday night together. The following day was Father's Day, so that's why she was, you know, home and spending time with them. And that night they had their favorite dinner of fried chicken and watched a movie together. At the same time, down the street, Kevin and Alicia McConnell were hosting a high school graduation party for their family friend, Evan Jennings. As the party kind of wound down, Pastor Brian Jennings, who was Evan's father, loaded up a bunch of chairs from the party that they had borrowed from their church into his truck to drive them back to the church because they were done using them. And meanwhile, there's Ethan Couch, who is 16 years old, an extremely wealthy child who was living alone at the time because his parents owned a steel company and they just made insane amounts of money. Just built a giant, giant mansion in Fort Worth, Texas, and they had already moved to it. They decided they would just let Ethan stay home, you know. At age 16, he started driving, let me tell you, at age 13. They started letting him just take quick drives to the convenience store and stuff. They decided to leave their 16-year-old home alone in that house to party and fuck around with his friends. And that's exactly what he did. On that night, he was having a party of his own at his house with a bunch of other young teenagers. And that night, they decided to steal beer from Walmart. At his house, they were playing beer pong, and they were also doing shots of Everclear, which, if you've never had Everclear, it is the nastiest alcohol vodka ever. It is like straight alcohol. It makes you extremely, extremely drunk because it's just cheap garbage, basically. But back at the Boyles' house, it was around 11 p.m. They'd actually just finished their movie, and they were hanging out in their living room. But then they noticed some commotion coming from outside their window, and they went outside to see what it was. And the three walked out there. There was a wrecked Mercury Mountaineer, and it had spun out and crashed into their neighbor's culvert. The driver was really upset. She was 24 years old. Her name was Brianna Mitchell, and she was actually on her way home on a Saturday night from a catering job. So Shelby offered to let her use her cell phone to call her mother, and Brian Jennings is coming down the road at the same time. He pulls over to help and just make sure everyone's okay, because this guy's like, you know, a pastor, he's this really nice guy, and he had two other kids in the back of his truck.
He tells us, he's like, no, y'all sit tight, I'll be back in just a minute.
He told them to just sit there for a minute and that he would be back. Meanwhile, Ethan Couch, he's partying at home, he's trashed. They were also using Xanax, Valium, a bunch of other things, and they were completely incoherent. His friend Star Teague asked to go to a convenience store, and Ethan decided to be a hotshot and drive her. And even after multiple people asked him not to, he insisted that he drive her there, completely wasted. Not only that, but he decided to show off. So they're in Texas, two-lane road out in the country, and Ethan kept driving into the other lane and playing chicken with other cars, and then driving back at the last minute. So at this moment, Eric Boyles decided to take a mailbox that had been knocked over by the car up to the front of his house. So he happened to not be standing with them at this moment, but everyone else was helping Brianna, standing in front of her car. And then here comes Ethan in his truck, a big truck, driving 70 miles an hour down a two-lane road playing chicken. And he must not have seen them or something, because then he plowed into the back of Brianna's car, pushed that out of the way, hit all four people that were standing there at 70 miles an hour with zero evidence of any type of braking. Eric heard the sound of the crash from inside his house, and he said it was so loud that it sounded like an explosion had gone off and shook his house.
I felt, you know, we don't live in California, but it would almost think, you'd almost think you just had an earthquake. I mean, the house shook.
So he went running out there, obviously. And when he went out there, he saw a bunch of car parts, scattered debris, and people scattered around.
There were already people out there in front of the house. It was just debris everywhere, a table and chairs and car parts and everything else. I walked in the road, and the first thing I did was I found there was a male laying in the road, wasn't moving at all.
So first thing he did was try to find his wife and daughter, obviously, and first he found his wife, Holly.
I'm calling out Holly and Shelby as I walk, and I kind of got halfway between the road and my fence, and that's when I found Holly. And when I found her, I mean, there was no doubt that she was gone.
She was in such bad condition, he knew there was no chance for her and that she was gone. So he left her and moved on to try to find his daughter, Shelby. And it's extremely sad, but he said Shelby didn't even look like herself. That's how mangled she was from being hit by a truck at 70 miles an hour. And she was thrown up against a fence. That's how far her body flew. Very shortly after the crash happened, Brian Jennings' really close friend, Kevin McConnell, pulled up on the scene and noticed the chairs that he just came from the same party that Brian was at. He saw all the chairs and realized, oh my God, Brian must have been in this accident. And right after that, his wife, Shauna, pulled up on the scene as she was, you know, going home as well. Kevin found Brian and started trying to do CPR on him, and Shauna pulled up as Kevin was doing that. I'm sure it was a horrific scene.
I really thought, okay, he got hit, but he's gonna be okay. And I'm thinking, God wouldn't do that to me.
So obviously news of this horrific accident spread all across social media and all the news networks very, very quickly. And where's Ethan Couch at this point? Ethan Couch left the scene, literally fucking left. A woman named Shauna Clark and her teenage son Corbin were driving and they saw a passed out teenager in a ditch. They pulled over obviously to help this person, thinking he was a drunk or hurt individual. And his mom went to go get help and Corbin sat with him and listened to what he told Corbin.
And I kept saying, hey, what's your name? What's your name? He'd say, what's your name? And he said, hey man, I'm Ethan, I can get you out of all this. I was like, I guess he thought I was involved, but he was like, yeah, just remember my name, I'll get you out of all this. He kept saying that.
So clearly has no ounce of sympathy. Apparently when EMS workers came to help Ethan, he was extremely resistant to any medical attention and was just trying to get out of there. And at one point he started saying he couldn't afford an ambulance, which is complete bullshit. His parents are so loaded. Four people died that night. Holly Boyles, Shelby Boyles, Brianna Mitchell, and Pastor Brian Jennings.
Tarrant County Sheriff now says the blood alcohol level of a 16-year-old driver involved in a deadly chain reaction accident was three times the legal limit.
But the boy has not been arrested, even though the slew of anticipated charges were listed on the accident report, including four counts of intoxication manslaughter.
Tonight we're hearing the chaos in the moments after a truck full of teens
slammed into three cars, killing three Good Samaritans
and a woman with a flat tire.
The chain reaction crash happened late Saturday night.
And again, the sheriff says that teenage driver of the truck has not been arrested.
Obviously, this small town was extremely upset, and officials decided to charge Ethan as an adult and try to go for as hard of a punishment as they could. They were seeking 20 years, which in my opinion isn't even enough. He was charged with four counts of intoxication manslaughter and two counts of intoxication assault. So Ethan Couch admitted guilt, but it wasn't until the sentence hearing that this case became really famous. Obviously, he was able to get a really great team of lawyers. His parents are wealthy. They obviously don't want their kid to go to jail, so they pulled out as much money as they could for the situation. At his hearing in December of 2013, his legal team called prominent psychologist Dr. G. Dick Miller to the stand to testify on Couch's behalf. And the defense that they used was unheard of. Dr. Miller claimed that Ethan was suffering from a case of affluenza. Yes, people, that is affluenza, not influenza, which is the flu. Affluenza, as in affluent, as in rich, as in too rich to take responsibility. They basically argued that Ethan's parents were horrible, shitty, rich parents that didn't pay enough attention to their kids and never taught him anything, so he didn't know the difference between right and wrong. Now, yes, I do think that Ethan's parents have a lot of blame to carry here, if not most of it, but Ethan showed his lack of remorse. Never, ever has he apologized or acknowledged the amount of damage and suffering he's caused these families. So that pisses me off. He didn't know better than to drive drunk, especially when he was playing chicken. That night, Ethan had a blood alcohol level that was three times higher than the legal limit. During Dr. Miller's deposition, he said that he strongly recommended in criminal sentencing that Couch needed to be separated from his parents and their parenting that strongly enabled the deadly accident. The prosecution obviously was advocating for 20 years behind bars, but the judge decided that Ethan was a little too white and a little too privileged and a little too rich for jail, and decided to sentence him to 10 years of probation and time in an extremely nice rehab facility that was paid for with taxpayer dollars because his parents claimed they couldn't afford it.
No, I looked at the website, I looked at what his schedule is going to be every day of the week, and it's cooking classes, one-on-one nutritional counseling, mixed martial arts, gym, equine therapy, he gets to ride horses, yoga, meditation, he has gym access, he can get beach access, if he's on good behavior, he can get television access. How is that punishment in any form for killing four people? You're concerned about the justice system, you live in this community, is this justice? I mean, I know maybe the kid won't have his Xbox, but I'd love to go to a facility for a year and do meditation and yoga and learn cooking skills and have one-on-one nutritional counseling and ride horses. You know, that sounds great to the man who has lost his wife and his daughter and sees this young man who has ruined his life, has killed his wife, has killed his daughter, has killed two other people as well. What consequence is there really for him killing four people?
For 10 years, the judge will have the discretion at any time she chooses to send this kid to the penitentiary.
But this same judge sentenced a 14-year-old, not affluent African-American child, young man, who killed one person after punching that person and they fell down and hit their head. This judge sent that 14-year-old to the Texas Juvenile Justice Department for 10 years. And that kid is gonna be in there till they're 19 years old. Does that seem fair? This is a prime example that there's a separate system of justice if you have money.
If you have a lot of money, you get people with more skills. You get a better singer. We have you tonight. I'm sure that, you know, you make more than the local guy here. That's just the way the world works. And there's some good things about that, some not so good things.
Now, obviously, people were infuriated, especially the family members of people that died. Few others were injured, including Sergio Molina, who was a teen that was thrown out of the bed of Couch's truck, and he has a serious brain injury now and can no longer speak or move. These are Ethan's parents, Fred and Tanya Couch. They got married in 1996, but they actually divorced, likely over the stress from all of this, in 2015. Then, on December 2nd of 2015, a video surfaced of Ethan Couch at a party where there was alcohol.
Watch this guy clownishly leap onto the table. Right there, that's Couch, laughing hysterically without a care in the world.
Obviously, this is a huge violation of his probation. So the next day, his probation officer called him and ordered a mandatory drug test. Ethan, knowing that he would fail and go to jail, convinced his mother to help him in this situation, and Tanya decided to do so. She withdrew $30,000 from her bank account, and then some point between then and December 10th, they went to Mexico, he and his mother, to escape from police.
Well, first of all, let me stress that beer pong is the least of my concerns. The fact, however, that he would be playing beer pong with all of his friends, sliding half naked up and down a table covered in glasses of beer, is totally repulsive to me. And this is why. He killed four people. We can all laugh and make light of him playing beer pong. He killed four people. One, a mother and a daughter. Right, how do you think that father slash husband feels?
On December 28th of 2015, Ethan and Tanya Couch were arrested in Mexico after Ethan, a few days earlier, placed a Domino's pizza delivery order from his cell phone, not realizing that they could track that type of thing, and that's how they found him. He'd also spent that entire week at strip clubs, drinking, was just completely intoxicated most of the time that he was in Mexico with his mother.
He is not the kind of person who rehabilitates, who learns his lesson. And so to say it was a surprise to us, not at all.
We continue to follow developing news out of Mexico this morning. Ethan Couch, the Texas teen, who is described as having affluenza, and his mom have been arrested by Mexican authorities.
According to NBC Dallas, U.S. Marshals asked Mexican authorities to help arrest Tanya and Ethan Couch several days ago, and they were finally arrested last night. According to the Mexican prosecutor, they are now being held on immigration charges, or by immigration authorities, we should say.
On December 30th, Tanya was deported, but oddly enough, Ethan stayed in Mexico. So Tanya flew back with investigators to the U.S. Her bond was set for $1 million. It wasn't until January 28th, 2015 that they were finally able to deport Ethan back to the United States. And he was booked instantly in a juvenile detention facility. This is when he was sentenced to only 2 years in prison, and he has completed those 2 years, and that's why I decided to talk about this, as he was just recently let out of jail. His mother is still behind bars, but Ethan is out, and apparently he's changed in jail and has learned his lessons, become a whole new person, but I doubt it. During his current probation, he's required to wear an ankle monitor. He has to wear an alcohol detecting patch. He has to submit to drug testing and abide by a 9 p.m. curfew, which is all things that should have happened his first go around. But as of right now, Ethan Couch is free, and those people have to live with the fact that this kid only served 2 years for the lives of 4 people who were innocently killed from his reckless behavior. I wanna know what you guys think about this case. I wanna know what you think about affluenza, the sentencing, what you think should have happened. What would have been the ideal solution to all of this in closing for all of this? Like, what would you have sentenced if you were a judge? Or do you think affluenza is actually a reasonable explanation for what Ethan did? Let me know by leaving a comment below, and be sure to also give this video a thumbs up if you liked learning about this case and want me to continue giving you guys updates on it. But that's it for me today, guys. I hope you're having a great day, and I will see you next time.